is important. Set it just over here. So feel free to drink some if you think that you need it. I also wanted to show you something. I couldn't wait for the next time that I see you. Don't worry, it's still gonna be relaxing. But just wanted to show you something that I got recently. Science-y company, but I got this for free because they did a little pop-up stall at our lab to try and sell us their products. Some kind of dried soil discs that apparently expand when you add water to them. Battery's running out. And basically, Rosa pudica can be grown quite easily without extensive optimization of conditions. Take a break from growing cells and enjoy growing your mimosa. There were some bad jokes in there. I mean, not even jokes, just... Anyway. I was excited to show you. But... I've got this little pot here. Soil. I don't think what they gave would be enough to fill this, but unless it expands a crazy amount. Okay. That's enough about my new plant. Thank you. is narrow and twists back on itself. He takes each step slowly, sliding himself along the wall, his boots meeting each tread with a thud. Near the bottom, he pauses for a moment, looking back the way he has come. Then, suddenly resolute, he leaps the final three stairs, as is his habit. He stumbles as he lands, falling to his knees on the flagstone floor. It is a close, windless day in late summer, and the downstairs room is slashed by long strips of light. The sun glowers at him from outside, the windows, the latticed slabs of yellow set into the plaster. He gets up, rubbing his legs. He looks one way, up the stairs. He looks the other, unable to decide which way he should turn. The room is empty, the fire ruminating in its grate, orange embers below soft, spiraling smoke. His injured kneecaps throb in time with his heartbeat. He stands with one hand resting on the latch of the door to the stairs, the scuffed leather tip of his boot raised, poised for motion, for flight. His hair, light-coloured, almost gold, rises up from his brow in tufts. There is no one here. He sighs, drawing in the warm, dusty air, and moves through the room, out of the front door, and onto the street. The noise of barrows, horses, vendors, people calling to each other, a man hurling a sack from an upper window doesn't reach him. He wanders along the front of the house, and into the neighboring doorway. The smell of his grandparents' home is always the same, a mix of wood smoke, polish, leather, wool. It is similar, yet indefinably different from the adjoining two-roomed apartment built by his grandfather in a narrow gap next to the larger house where he lives with his mother and sisters. Sometimes he cannot understand why this might be. The two dwellings are, after all, separated by only a thin, wattled wall. But the air in each place is of a different ilk, a different scent, a different temperature. This house whistles with drafts and eddies of air, with the tapping and hammering of his grandfather's workshop, with the raps and calls of customers at the window, with the noise and welter of the courtyard out the back, the sound of his uncles coming and going. But not today. The boy stands in the passageway, listening for signs of occupation. He can see from here that the workshop to his right is empty, the stools at the benches vacant, the tools idle on the counters, a tray of abandoned gloves, like handprints left out for all to see. The vending window is shut and bolted tight. There is no one in the dining hall. Left. A stack of napkins is piled on the long table. An unlit candle, a heap of feathers, nothing more. He calls out, a cry of greeting, a questioning sound. Once, twice he makes this noise, then he cocks his head, listening for a response. Nothing. Just like the creaking of beams expanding gently in the sun. Sorry, just the creaking of beams expanding gently in the sun, the sigh of air passing under doors, between rooms, the swish of linen drapes, the crack of the fire, the indefinable noise of the house at rest, empty. His fingers touch.